so wonderful is your unfailing love. Your cross has spoken mercy over me. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart could fully know how glorious, how beautiful you are.
Till I met you. In our Bible reading plan, we are in the Gospel of Luke, and today I would like us to look at Luke chapter 9, verses 28 to 37. Our key verse is verse 29. We're looking at the King in his glory. Now it came to pass, about 8 days after these sayings, that he took Peter, John, and James and went up on the mountain to pray. As he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered, and his robe became white and glistening. And behold, two men talked with him, who were Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his decease, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. But Peter and those with him were heavy with sleep. And when they were fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Then it happened, as they were parting from him, that Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here, and let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were fearful as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son, hear him." When the voice had ceased, Jesus was found alone, but they kept quiet and told no one in those days any of the things they had seen. Now it happened on the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, that a great multitude met him. As Jesus prayed, the appearance of his face was altered, and his robe became white and glistening. As far as the gospel record is concerned, the transfiguration was the only occasion during Christ's earthly ministry when he revealed the glory of his person. Luke did not use the word transfigure, But he described the same scene that's recorded in Matthew 17:2. And let's read that. And he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as the light. Also in Mark 9:2. Now, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John and led them up on a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. The word transfigured means a change in appearance, a change that comes from within. And it gives us the word metamorphosis. There are many great spiritual experiences in the Bible that took place on mountains. Most of them were viewed by very few witnesses. We have, for example, on Mount Moriah, Abraham, who went to offer up his son Isaac. On Mount Sinai, amid lightning and thunder, Moses received the Ten Commandments. On Mount Carmel, Elijah called down the fire of God and devastated the religion and priests of Baal. We've got the wilderness temptations, which included one from a mountaintop. Christ died on Mount Calvary. On the Mount of Ascension, a cloud received him out of the onlooker's sight. It was probably on Mount Hermon where Jesus was transfigured. He had set himself apart for some very important reasons. First, Jesus set out to seek the guidance of his heavenly Father. He was on the way to the cross. He felt the need to pray. He never took a step without listening to the voice of God. When he had a problem, he did not proceed on human advice. He sought out a lonely place where he could fellowship with God. Second, Jesus needed strength. He was under tremendous pressure. Those who sought his life were closing in. He was misunderstood even by his friends. He was lonely. For even his most devoted disciples rebuked him when he tried to inform them of his impending death. His human nature recoiled against the prospect of death. He sought the fellowship of God. He received the fellowship of heavenly visitors who understood his mission. You see, Moses represented the law. He was the lawgiver who could see the fulfillment of the law in Jesus. Elijah, the greatest of the prophets, represented the prophets. You know, some even mistook Jesus as Elijah risen from the dead. The two conversed with Jesus about his departure. In Luke chapter 9, verse 31, and from the New International Version, we read, they spoke of his departure, which he was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem. In the New King James Version, which we're using, it speaks of his decease. And that word decease there means departure. In the New Testament, the word departure has the same meaning as the word exodus in the Old Testament. Exodus means going out. The second book of the Bible is titled Exodus, and it's about the meaning of the children of Israel going out from the bondage of Egypt into the land, the promised land that God had for them. What a description of the death of the believer. Death to the Christian is the going out from bondage of this life into the freedom of that glorious land our Savior is preparing for us. And as Jesus prayed, he was transfigured. A radiance shone from within. A cloud descended and the voice of God spoke his pleasure in his Son. It was a a high and holy hour. The three disciples who accompanied Jesus were deeply impressed and moved. The spiritual ecstasy that Peter experienced surpassed any other event in his life. The wonder and the adoration of the moment were overwhelming. You know, we can hear Peter saying, "Lord, it's good to be here. Let's stay here. This is as near to heaven as I can stand. Let us build three tents, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah, and as far as John and James and I are concerned, we'll be happy to sleep on the ground." But God rebuked Peter, and Jesus led the three disciples down into the valley where a crisis awaited them. You see, the nine remaining disciples had sought to heal a tragically ill boy and had not been successful in their efforts. The enemies of Jesus were exultant. It was a crisis for the kingdom as well as a crisis for the father and the sick son. You have to understand that our impotence is an embarrassment to Jesus. Our lack of faith reflects on him. With a word, he healed the boy and gave his disciples a lesson on faith. And there are two vital lessons we learn from this experience of worship on the Mount. First, communion with God transfigures. Worship changes the worshiper. The disciples could see the difference in Jesus' countenance. And for those of us who have been going through the round table Bible study, even in the last one we had on Thursday, we saw that as Moses went into the presence of God, the Shekinah glory of God caused Moses' face to shine. When he was on the mount, when he came down from the mount, Mount Sinai, after a time with God, the face of Moses shone. When he was in the tabernacle and he was in the presence of God, in that, when I said the tabernacle, the house, the tent of meetings, his face shone. When he was in the presence of God, something happened. We also know, as we read about the experience of the martyr Stephen, as he was being stoned, as he looked up and saw Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father, Stephen shone. The glory of God just was all over him. Shone. You can't be in the presence of God. You can't be a true worshiper and not be affected, impacted by God. Something happens. Neither of these men were aware that his face shone. Stephen wasn't aware of it. Moses wasn't aware of it. It was a genuine radiance. And we are always the last to notice it. Others see it. I read that Dr. George W. Truett, pastor of the First Baptist Church in Dallas, for most of the first half of the 20th century, he was a man of devout prayer and spirituality. And a columnist for the Dallas News wrote an article about the great pastor just a few years before he died. Truett went out one day. He came out from his study to an urgent appointment in downtown Dallas. As he walked down the busy street, his eyes straight ahead, his mind intent upon his mission, a man coming from the opposite direction got one glimpse of his face. That man's feet were bent on a mission of evil. He did not know the pastor. He had never seen him before. But there was something about his face, his eyes, and his bearing that prompted that man to turn aside from his sinful errand. And Dr. Truitt never knew of it until he read it in the Dallas News. So when we have that communion with God, and when God's glory is upon us, we don't see it, but others certainly do. And if we are where we ought to be with God, the glory of God, the presence of God that indwells us, can bring transformation to others. Secondly, prayer equips for the valley. Peter wanted to prolong the great moment on the mount, but there was a need to go down in the valley. Jesus' disciples could supply that need. We cannot live all our life on the mountain. Neither must we live all our life in the valley. We must climb the mountain and experience the worship of God. Then we must take the mountaintop back into the valley to those who have not been up to the mountain. We must witness the glory of God on the mountaintop so we may minister to the misery of men in the valley. We cannot live Sunday all 7 days of the week. You know, many times people say to me, oh, I'm so glad for Sunday. When I come together with the people of God on a Sunday, I'm so impacted. I'm so revived. I'm so inspired. You know, I feel God. I know I've been with God. But, oh, tomorrow's Monday. And they go into the Monday blues. We can't have Sunday all 7 days of the week. We must worship God and renew our bodies and minds and spirit. Then God gives us 6 weekdays back in the valley to take the spirit and inspiration and witness of the Lord's day to the people. What happens to us as we have that extraordinary fellowship with the Father will keep us. But we have to be able to share with others what God has put in us. We must meet God in the secret place and in the church meeting place. And thank God that the church has opened up again. We have to have that meeting with God so that we may meet sinful and needy people in the marketplace. That's what God wants to do. He wants to invigorate us. He wants to fill us. He wants to commune with us. That as we meet with him, we can share with others as they see that glory. I think of Moses as we were teaching in the round table Bible study. The glory of God was so bright on Moses that when he initially came out of God's presence, his face was bright with a brilliance. But what was realized, because Moses did not have a mirror, so he didn't know what was happening to him, but people must have told him that as time passed, the glory began to withdraw. The brightness was removed. So Moses veiled his face so the people did not see the withdrawing of the glory. But when he went back in to the presence of God, it was restored. He was bright again. And so he would veil his face so people wouldn't see the withdrawing of that glory. We have to constantly go back into that place of worship and fellowship with God to maintain the glory. And I'm so glad because Jesus now is that glory inside of us. We have to read his word. We have to worship, live in that place of worship that others will see what God is doing in our lives, that will see our worship. Needy, sinful people, as it were, in the marketplace, will see and know the God that's in us and find transformation. We take our needs to God so that we may be strengthened to meet the needs of other people. Jesus said, "You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you worship." We have not really worshipped unless our worship equips and motivates us to serve. So many of us want others to serve us. So many of us want others to facilitate our personal needs. But if we are true worshippers and followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, no matter what's happening in our lives, we take our needs to him. We go to him. He ministers to us. So at all times, no matter what we're going through, we've got something to give to somebody else because we're receiving from him. There are so many people who want to leave church or move away from God's people because they say, well, there's no one there for me. When I needed them, they weren't there. No, we've got to go to God so God meets our needs. Other people can't meet our needs. Only God can. And if we say that we're children of God, no matter how we're feeling, no matter how down we are or depressed or what's happening in our lives, we've got to make our way to God. We've got to worship anyhow. Somebody says, I'm going to say hallelujah anyhow. It's got to be hallelujah anyhow because we go into the presence of God because the glory of God comes upon us and is in us. And so we have not really worshipped unless our worship equips and motivates us to serve. We need the fire of God within us. How we long for the transfiguring experience of exalted worship, that we may be equipped to minister to the multitudes who hurt in the valley. As I close, there are so many people around us who are in that valley, in that dark place, in the valley of decision, not knowing what to do, where to go. And if we are the church, the body of Christ, we need to enter into that place with God when we ourselves don't feel we're on the mountaintop. Get ourselves in that place with him. Enter into worship. Jesus was at one of his lowest points. You know, we read how he went up there with the three disciples that was closest to them, and their eyes were heavy with sleep. At the time when he needed their support and their help, their humanity, their frailty failed. But he went to the Father, and the Father made provisions. We have to stop looking to people. We can love our friends, we can love those and appreciate those who want to support us, but comes a time when that human support is not enough. We need to seek God. We need to run into God. We need to come to that place of worship where we enter in to his presence and be lost in him, be clothed in his glory, where nothing else matters, where he can minister to us, and what we receive from him, we can take to a hurting people. We have been called to be ministers to the multitudes who hurt in the valley. You have to leave the mountaintop and go into the valley. But the experience of the mountaintop can so impact your life. Your fellowship with God can be so impactful that when you go into the valley, people will see the glory of God and their lives be transformed. I speak to every child of God, every one of you that dares to call yourself a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you have opened up doors where the enemy has come in and lied to you and robbed you of that place you have with God. Those of you who the glory has departed because you're not living right. You're not in the right place with God. Your heart has gone after other gods. And so you're living a life of pretense. And you can't survive there because you know it's not real. You know it's not genuine. You know you're not in relationship with God. I want to encourage you today, get back to the King who's in his glory. Get back to that place that you once knew with God. Go back to God and say, God, I am not where I should be. I'm not what I ought to be. But I know I was born for a purpose. There's no point looking here and running there for someone to facilitate and make you feel better and get you right and give you the words you want to hear that you feel you can function. No. You need to go back to God. You need to deal with your life. You need to deal with where you're at. You need to say, God, I have broken my relationship with you. And I need you to restore me. And for those of you who are walking with God, and there are things before you that seem so hard and so difficult, decisions that you have to make, seek God. Just as Jesus sought the Father, as he knew the cross was before him, and as he realized, his human body realized the full import of all that that meant, as he stood there alone on that mount, he was not alone. God sent him encouragement. God ministered to him in a way that no one else could minister to him. God knew what he needed, and God made provisions. And in that moment, the glory of God was revealed. If you will find God, look for God, go to that quiet place, take that journey up the mountain in worship. Get to the top of the mountain and lose yourself in the cloud of God's glory through worship. I'm telling you, you'll experience that awesome, awesome life transforming experience that will take you to the next level, take you back down in the valley, and cause you to be God's minister to bring transformation to those that need help. God bless you.
Equipping the saints, reaching the lost, WWMF, we invite